Good evening. So I'm grateful to DES for giving me this opportunity to interact with the enlightened audience of Pune. This is perhaps the second time I will be delivering a lecture here. The last time was as part of a discussion on Article 370 at ILS, and this was before the lockdown, in the before the pre-new normal, and this was, I think, in September or August 2019. I've always loved this city for its own history, for its rich culture. I've waited to enter the hallowed portals of Bori for quite some time now. I haven't had the opportunity yet, but I hope to. But the good news is I have sourced a significant amount of my material, at least my reading material, from Bori as part of my research during the writing of the first book. Starting from P.V. Carney's The History of Dharmashastras, I also ended up ordering a lot of books on Vedic bibliography. Bori's literature has significantly helped me shape my thoughts. I'm still in the process of wrapping my head around the deep scholarship that has been produced by that institution. I can't remotely claim to have understood everything that it has produced because it requires years of training. I'm still in the process of doing it. So I'm happy to actually engage with you. I'm slowly switching to an interactive format as much as possible because I think there are quite a few things that I'd like to address from the audience's perspective. Shri Nitin Apteji has already given the sandarbha, or he has set the tone for this discussion. So I'd like to open the floor for questions from the audience right from the word go. So let this be an entirely interactive session. So whatever questions you feel like asking, as long as it is related to the book or to the theme of the book, I'm more than happy to ask. So please feel free to shoot your questions. I make a typical standard request everywhere, so allow me to just repeat those requests. Please feel free to ask whatever provocative question you want. I don't evade any of those questions. However, keep the tone civil. That's the only request. And second, keep your questions crisp and short so that everybody else gets an opportunity. Introduce yourself and then start the question.
If India wishes to reclaim the civilizational state in the context of decolonization as against post-colonialism, while at the same time capture some aspects of the modern, rational, Western, secular concepts such as the sovereignty of individual or separation of religion and state, where do we start? What would you say?
Allow me to disagree with the premise of your question itself, which is to say your question has two parts. One is that we start on a decolonial journey and also take certain aspects of modern, liberal, Western society, which includes the separation of the state and religion. There is a serious problem with the question for the simple reason that you proceed on the assumption that the separation of the state from the religion is something that is universal, when in fact in the book I've specifically addressed this to make the point that it is not universal. It is specifically traceable to Christian political theology, and therefore before a non-Christian society embarks upon a decolonial journey, it has to ask itself whether it really wants to be governed by that particular principle. So the desirability of it is the question that needs to be addressed first, and second, whether this is consistent with your own ethos is a question that you have to answer. And I refuse to use the word modern, especially after this particular book. I would prefer to use the word contemporary as a substitute for modern, because modernity as a concept and as a word has significant colonial interpretations. Someone might say it's possible to divorce the word from its meaning, but that would be fundamentally stupid and illogical for a different reason. So a few days ago, I just began my training in Sanskrit, and one of my teachers ended up initiating me into something which is one of the verses from Kalidasa's Raghuvamsam. It goes something like this. Vagartha viva sampruktau, vagartha pratipattaye, jagatav pitarau vande, parvati parameshwaram. So I ended up asking him, what is the meaning of this? Vagartha viva sampruktau. So that's the first sentence. Vak and artha. The word and its meaning, sampruktau, they are enmeshed, they are inseparable. Vagartha pratipattaye. So you're asking the deities, namely Shiva and Parvati, to bless you with the ability to attain that state where you never understand a word independent of its meaning, and whenever you understand a word, you always understand it with the meaning. So Vagartha Viva Sampraktav, Vagartha Pratipattaye, Jagatav Pitarav Vande. So I pray to the ones who are the parents of the universe, Parvati Parameshwaram. That's basically how it goes. So therefore, applying the logic that a word and its meaning cannot be separated, modernity and its underlying Western connotation cannot be separated, because it has at least half a millennium of history that informs the evolution of the word and what it has translated to. Specifically, what has it translated to? Every time you try to apply modernity to a non-Christian institution, the very premise is that that institution is outdated and is in serious need of reform. That's the premise with which you start. And therefore, you brand that particular institution traditional, orthodox, conservative, outdated, whatnot. And therefore, I refuse to use the word modernity. And consequently, the first response to your question, or the first level of response to your question, is that I am not interested in becoming modern, dare I say it. I wish to be relevant, not modern. Very, very clear. I wish to be contemporary, not modern. And I don't wish to subscribe to or live by the Western benchmark of what constitutes liberal. We have our own philosophy. And when you say that decoloniality is the journey that the civilization must embark upon, then the first thing that you do is to draw your values from within your own philosophy. So I am not going to try and find the paryayvachi or the equivalent or the counterpart of liberalism in my philosophy. I would simply ask, what does my philosophy say, independent of what the Western man has said? And I will ask myself, how do I make my own philosophy relevant and contemporary to the times that I live in, so that it is applicable to the challenges that I face and the realities I'm surrounded by? That is the only question you should be asking. I don't need to live by the standards or the benchmarks or the metrics set by the Westerner, period. That's one. Second, the point being made about the separation of the let's say state and church, clearly that's a Christian philosophy. Whether dharmic notions of state subscribe to the very same separation is a question that I'd like to ask. Because what is it that you're fundamentally asking? Whether the state is governed by the principles of dharma, and therefore what is its treatment of people living in that particular region, and how does it choose to operate, and how does it choose to define itself? Now the problem is, when you apply separation of the state from the church, you are applying the framework of religion. When you are applying dharmic principles, first you start with the equation that dharma is not religion, and therefore a dharmic state is not necessarily a theocratic state. It is a state that is governed by principles of dharma, with dharma not being religion. Therefore, it is governed by certain principles which we believe are immutable and intransient, and therefore universal. Okay? If you understand that particular premise, this constant dying need to fit Indian society into the Western model of the separation of the state and the church will immediately fall away, it will wither away. Now, where is all of this coming from? It comes from the notion that the Western society has been able to progress precisely because of its secular tendencies, and which means it has kept religion out of its political life, and therefore it has succeeded on the material front, is the assumption on the basis of which you operate, and that is where your question is coming from. Because you can't have something as a destination without asking yourself why this particular goal. So your goal is, I want to be like the Western society. Western societies seem to have achieved the ideal state of separation of the state and the church, and until I reach that particular state, I don't think I will reach the Western model of development, is your position. Now, this position is first of all ahistoric for multiple reasons, because you haven't understood how the separation of the church from the state works in the Western society itself. That's why I spent about 50 to 60 pages of the book dealing with this particular issue in significant detail, starting from biblical verses that address this particular issue, going to scholarly literature on the subject. There is not a single Western state that has chosen to abandon its Christian political theology or its Christian identity. That's a fact. You start with that fact. The moment you start with a factual premise that there is not a single Western state that has abandoned its Christian identity, the next question would be, how can you be a Christian state and still call yourself secular? If you happen to be secular, you shouldn't be having, let's say, a religious identity of your own. The problem is we have misunderstood secular. Secular has always been preceded, there's a prefix which is constantly missing. It is Christian secular, not purely secular. Christian secularism translates to the following position. One, the state shall have a very specific Christian identity, which means it will also have a very specific denominational identity. Catholic or Protestant, within Protestant, you have the Lutheran Church or you have the Calvinist Church, and then subsequent denominations have come about. So you need to choose your identity. And the separation of the church from the state simply translates to not non-interference of religion with the state, but non-interference of the state with the activities of the church. So that particular policy was meant to insulate the church from political interference and from the interference of the state arm. It was meant to secure the freedom of religion and religious institutions from the state. Compare that with how we understand separation of the state from church in this country. So first of all, your understanding of what is secularism is wrong. How it applies in the mothership, therefore, Europe is incorrect. You have not understood that. And still we keep calling this secularism as the value by which we are all supposed to live by. So I refuse the second part of the question. I will reformulate the question as follows. If I have X number of philosophies which have given the best of scholarship possible on the nature of state and how it must conduct itself, and I have several baskets of options to choose from given the longevity of this particular civilization, which of these principles can I pick and choose from to formulate a contemporary Bharat which is still operating within the four corners of Dharma and which is still in a position to actively engage with the rest of the world without receding into its own shell? That is the, let's say, that is the goal that you should be aiming for. I don't wish to prove myself on your anvils, okay? Now, how do you go about doing this? There is the second question. You cannot have an answer to this without sufficient preparation in this particular regard. And the kind of scholarship that went into this particular subject until 1947 is vastly more superior compared to the kind of scholarship that has been produced after 1947. In fact, after 1947, we have pushed ourselves further into the arms of coloniality, and therefore we have almost arrived at time T0, so you have to start from scratch again. Because the situation is so bad that people are not even aware of the existence of scholarship of the late 20th century or the early 21st century, where this was discussed over and over again. So the first job is to unlearn what you think you know and then start applying this decoloniality as far as the question of the state is concerned. It will take at least another 15 to 20 years before this is ready. Because the acknowledgement of the problem itself seems to be a huge problem. Nobody wants to acknowledge the fact that they're living under the framework which doesn't resonate with our civilizational ethos. And we constantly try and ask ourselves this question, whether the civilization and the constitution enjoy the same relationship as India and Pakistan. Okay, and that is because you have not understood the creature called coloniality or colonial consciousness. So if at all someone were to ask me what is the central contribution of the book, it is not the identification of the problem, because that was already done by better scholars and much informed scholars. The contribution of the book is to push it into public discourse, and second, apply it specifically in the context of constitution, so that you're able to see both together. So the originality of the book significantly lies in connecting three different verticals: the literature on coloniality, the literature on civilization, and the literature on constitution, and bringing it under one roof. That's what I have done. And even if I say so myself, there's not a single book before which has done this. Because this particular literature has been consciously kept outside the scope of public discussion. Decolonial literature has been completely kept outside the scope of public discussion. Because India's academic departments have been hijacked by Nehruvian Marxism as well as post-colonialism, which have kept you outside and which have secluded this discussion completely from what has been happening in Latin America. So therefore, what I've asked in the book is, if Latin American societies have the freedom to apply a filter which allows them to explore their pre-colonial past, why is that freedom deprived of us? Why is it that we don't have the very same luxury to ask the very same questions? And if it is your logic that Latin American societies can look at their pre-Christian past, why can't I look at my pre-Christian, pre-Islamic past? What comes in the way? This bogey called secularism. And therefore, understanding this creature is very, very important, because that stands in the way of you and your ability to access your heritage. That is where I see the central contribution of the book. So let's reframe the question itself, and then we'll look at the right answers. Next. A lady, if possible.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, please, go on.
My name is Vikrant Rajay. So my question is about how to get rid of English, because one of the important aspect of Indianization of judiciary or converting India to a Bharat is getting out of clutches of English, because we do not have any common language. What can be a roadmap? Can Sanskrit be the alternative? So what are your views on this? Because Ambedkar has once said that Sanskrit is a good option as a national language. Thank you.
Thanks for citing Ambedkar, but I think this question can be addressed without falling back on him. So I don't need to prove my points necessarily by the touchstone of Dr. Ambedkar. He may be relevant for certain aspects. He need not be discussed on every subject. Now, as far as the question of a common language is concerned, there is a discussion, forget Dr. Ambedkar, by Sri Lokanath Mishra in the Constituent Assembly debates, who is the father of the current MP from Puri, Sri Pinaki Mishra, a senior advocate in the Supreme Court. Go through the discussions on this particular subject. This was actually proposed actively when the language policy was being discussed. And they were discussing the provisions, I think, starting from Article 351 onwards to 343 onwards, in terms of what shall be the transactional language of the Supreme Court, what shall be the transactional language of the government institutions. This was a discussion that was going on. So Sanskrit was certainly proposed. I think the solution is not that difficult. Again, the history surrounding the solution is a serious problem, because will this be accepted in certain parts of the southern states? I'm not sure of it. Will it be accepted in the northeast? I'm not sure of it. Will it be accepted in Kashmir? I'm not sure of it. Will it be accepted in Bengal as it stands today? I have no idea. Or will it be even accepted in Maharashtra as it stands today? I really have no idea. Okay? So as far as I'm concerned, none of these discussions are possible without addressing the central question of distortion of history. Because Sanskrit has now been given a certain racial connotation. It has been given a certain colonizing connotation. And we are much more comfortable accepting the language of the admitted colonizer, namely the British man. But we seem to be very uncomfortable accepting the language of the alleged colonizer, namely the so-called Aryan. Okay. So I think unless and until we address the question of history and whether this particular language, see, there are two aspects. One is, of course, the question of self-esteem, pride. But the second question is a very serious and practical question of whether this is feasible. What is the economic cost? What is the cost of integration? How long will it take before we actually think of Sanskrit as not a dead language and as a language which is meant for transaction? That is a question which I'm not sure of. Because you see, at least other countries invested significantly in their education policy and language policy immediately after independence. Anybody who's read, and I've cited this example more than once, but let me repeat it for whatever it's worth. Hebrew was practically a dead language until the early 20th century. Until the Jewish Congress was set up, I think, in 1897 by Theodore Herzl. And then they started thinking of creation of the state of Israel, namely the Jewish state, Der Judenstaat, that's what he said in his book. And they then started asking themselves, what shall be the common language? Because you see, by that time, for 2000 years, the Jewish community had lived as a diaspora in multiple countries. somewhere in Russia, somewhere in Poland, somewhere in Germany, somewhere in Africa, Ethiopia, in all these places, Syria, Iraq. So the question was, if all these people come back, they have forgotten Hebrew, what is the common language that they shall speak in? So there was one madman called Yehuda ben Eliezer, who said Hebrew shall be the common language. And people branded him a crackpot during his life and time. But ultimately, when they set up their education system, they decided that Hebrew shall not only be revived, it shall be mainstreamed through the education policy. Okay. Ultimately, that madman proved to be the prophet, and he turned out to be right. Unfortunately, India still hasn't produced that one madman who can actually assert this and push it hard. Okay. Who says, no matter what, you guys can label me, you can call me whatever you want, but I am not changing my position one bit, and this is the only language that shall work. Because ultimately, history is not created by people who are agreeable. History is actually created by people who are disagreeable, who are intransigent, who say, main raste se nahi hatunga, jo karna hai, kar lo. Which means you will have to either kill me or you have to work around me. These are the only two options that you give to the rest of the world. We have arrived at a spot where there must be a certain degree of civilizational intransigence to basically say, we will not change this position any further. This is our position. Those who can take it can, those who can't can leave it and also leave. If that position is something that you're not willing to take, after 20 years you'll continue to ask the very same question. So I'm basically telling you, address the issues surrounding the politics of Sanskrit. The caste politics of Sanskrit, the religious politics of Sanskrit, and the racial politics of Sanskrit, and then we can have a common conversation. Because I refuse to buy this nonsense that prior to the introduction of English, Bharatiyas were incapable of talking to each other. Theek hai? Aise to nahi ho raha tha na? Okay. Apparently, we were transacting business with Rome, but the Odia was not talking to the Telugu because English nahi tha na? Kya kare? Arre re, aapko English nahi tha, hum aapse baat nahi karenge. Right? So that seems to be the beauty of our understanding today. We don't want to ask this question. If there were permits, if there were, let's say, Janapada to Janapada permits, and they were transacting business, and all of this was actually happening, what is the language? Why don't we ask that question? So during the course of the Padmanabha Swami case, the one thing I learned is that in the vaults of the Padmanabha Swami temple, among the treasures that you find is also the Roman coin, because they used to transact. Why? What did Rome need from us? Spices. What did they give in return? Gold. So Roman coins are there, clearly establishing business. So kya sign language mein baat kar rahe the ye log? So agar ye unke saath baat kar sakte hain, what is happening here? Internally, what was going on? You were even transacting business with Misr, which is Egypt. Which comes from Egypt itself, comes from the word Copt, because Coptic Christians were among the earliest Christians to convert to Christianity. Coptics was effectively the name that was given to the people of Egypt initially. So the point is, if this was happening, why are we giving this business, this entire impression that Sanskrit was the language of the elite? No. There are multiple levels of it. One is the advanced language, which obviously is meant to be discussed between the elites. But then there is also the Samanya Bhasha. Are you telling me that the language of Hindi itself, which is applied on the street, is the same as that is applied between the academics of Hindi? Not possible, right? So I think this requires a fair degree of investment in research. Because you see, solution ki baat nahi ho rahi hai. You are first of all trying to address the politics around every issue. Name one issue in this country which can be separated from the politics that has been created around it. Language, gender, caste, religion, Rashtriya identity, everything. So you have to be able to deal with that. Unfortunately, I don't think there is even an intellectual investment on that particular front with state support. Whatever is happening through individual efforts. And whatever is happening because of some madman actually burning the midnight oil and giving up his personal life to do this. A lot of people have done this, and they have died bitter deaths. A lot of people have done this in the previous generation without any support from anyone. So therefore, let us first respect those people who are seriously working on these subjects and give them the support needed. Solutions will emerge. If not in one generation, at least in the next generation. Because some of these issues which have been in, which are suffering as a consequence of investment of over 200 years, you can't hope to address it within 10 years or 15 years. But the beginning must be made. Once the beginning is made, some people will start taking it seriously and even pursue it as a matter of choice of career. That's when this entire thing starts. How many people can you actually show me today in the development sector and in the language sector who have focused on producing papers which explain how we come out with an Indic language policy, which speaks of mainstreaming of Indic languages as part of a transactions, as part of a state institutions, and creating a common language? Why is that a discussion that's not there even at the PhD level? Forget the state level. Because there is no incentive for it. Aap likhenge, uske baad kya hoga? Kisi library mein padha rahega? Kaun usko dekhega? So that is where the role of the state comes. The state, its biggest strength is to create a multiplier effect. That is, if the state becomes the launchpad for a certain policy, X is capable of becoming X raised to the power of 10. So it has the ability to create an order of magnitude effect. And therefore, state investment is significantly necessary. But if the state is stuck in the very same old done to death nonsense that I don't have an identity, I'm a secular state, I don't have any relationship with my civilization is not Hindu, yoga is not Hindu, Ayurveda is not Hindu, finally Hindu is also not Hindu. You de-Hinduize everything under the sun. Then what remains is, kya discussion karne ke liye kuch bacha kya hai? Ho gaya kaam. Next. The interesting part is it's not just the state which is making statements such as this. Some new age YouTube gurus have also started saying that yoga or Hindu ke beech mein koi antar hi nahi, there is no relationship at all. God save us. Yes.
Hello, sir.
Where is this? Please.
My name is Rishikesh, and I would like to thank you for writing a wonderful book. I haven't personally read it. My mother is reading it, and she has not given it to me. So, but she says it's beautiful. You know, it's great, so I believe her. Since I haven't read it, so I'll be asking question based on one of the threads that you started in the previous question, answer of the previous question. You said history is created by people who are disagreeable and not agreeable. You know, that one man, wo aadmi, ek aadmi, jo, he is intransigent and all those. My question is, when one man stands up and, you know, disagrees with the masses, people start to, if whether he is in power or not, people start to term him as, you know, a dictatorial or, you know, jhatka politics or whatever. So how would you counter that? So that's one question. And I had a second question.
Repeat that question, please, because I think there's a problem with the audio. Just repeat the question.
So my question was, when a person, a disagreeable person comes, people start to, term him as a dictator or authoritarian.
Understood.
Yeah. So how would you counter that? You know, if he has to create a certain person has to create a history by...
Oh, hold. Sorry.
So if he has to create a history, he has to go against the flow. How would he do that if he is being, termed a dictator or authoritarian? So that's one question. And second question is, since you are a Supreme Court lawyer, I wanted to ask this for a long time to a Supreme Court lawyer. There is a perception, at least for me, I don't know about the masses here, but there is a perception that the judiciary is not being fair in terms of, a better word would be, it is trying to, it is trying to impose the law, or it is trying to impose the rules where it can impose it, and it is not trying to, impose it where it cannot be forced. So, what are your comments on that? I hope you have understood.
I've understood the question. Okay.
Thank
you. Trying too hard to sound politically correct, but I got the message. So. And you're putting a lawyer in the spot with regard to an institution that he's practicing before. Very good. So, as far as the first question is concerned, so, take three people, A, B, and C. All three of them go to the same institution. Two of them come out relatively unchanged with respect to their attachment to their respective cultures. One person comes out spitting venom on his culture and with a sense of self-loathing. All three are being subjected to the same kind of education. But the impact seems to be different on different people. The reason is twofold. One, the other two groups are effectively producing institutions and, which is to say, societal institutions as well as family-based institutions, which manage to put a certain filter which is not changed by the education system. Whereas, as far as the majority community is concerned, it has effectively outsourced the value of introduction of any kind of value-based filter entirely to the school system, entirely to the rest of the society. The institutions or the traditional institutions which are supposed to give you the rooting in your culture have effectively been emasculated by the state. And the family, in turn, from a joint family system to the nuclear family system, its ability to provide cultural mooring as far as its children are concerned has already been reduced. Independent of that, they take a lot of pride in the degree of freedom that they give to the children as opposed to the kind of values that they impart to the children. Okay? When you have these fundamental problems, you are producing such intransigent people despite the system and in spurts, not with a certain degree of regularity. Because at the end of the day, it's a question of how many such intransigent people you're able to produce on a regular basis, who keep taking a shot at the system to keep changing it on an incremental basis, on a regular basis. Because this is not something that can be done in 1 year or 2 years. One generation needs to produce someone who takes a serious shot at the system, changes it in one way. Then that has to work. You've had Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, you've had Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and then you've had Sri Narendra Modi. You started off with Azharuddin, then you went to Saurav Ganguly, then you tried with Rahul Dravid. From there, you moved gradually towards Dhoni. And then you have come to Virat Kohli. Can you see the increase in confidence over successive generations? That happens everywhere. That applies in every aspect of life. So therefore, you should be looking at a vision which is fairly long term, and you must be investing in such institutions and individuals, because it is institutions that produce such individuals and those individuals themselves who build such institutions in the future. It's a cycle that feeds off itself. What you have done as a society is to undercut your autonomous institutions by making them completely dependent on the state, and I mean temples in this regard and the mathas in this regard. And the society is also more than happy to embrace secularism because, you see, it has traded English for culture. So therefore, your ability to produce intransigent people has gone down. I'll give you the lamest possible example or the crudest possible example on this particular subject in the most, let's say, outwardly fashion. Ask yourself how many people have the self-confidence, because we constantly expect women to wear saris. I challenge the men to wear dhotis and walk in an uber elitist mall. Do that first. Because when you are capable of doing that, then you have the right to pontificate to women what they are supposed to wear to preserve culture. Okay, that's one. Second, compare this with the confidence of other people who comfortably wear whatever they can and whatever they are expected of in any place. Wo airport ho, ya mall ho, ya cinema hall. That is where is the problem of inferiority complex. That is colonial consciousness, which I'm trying to highlight here. Understood? You can't seem to address the basic question of dressing and clothing. I would like to ask this simple question: how many people wear the kumkum or the vibhuti and get out of the house, but the moment they enter their office spaces, they wipe it off? I've seen so many people do that. I know of so many people who do that. That's not the case with other people. Whether he has to wear the topi or the pagadi, he's very comfortable wearing that. I respect them for it. I admire them for it, 100%. You can do the mulyankan later, ye sahi hai, galat hai, wo achhe hai, bure hai, that's a secondary issue. At least he is living by the principles that he believes in. He is more than comfortable, he is more than happy to cock the snook at the West and to basically say, aapka modernity gaya, tel lene, hum aise hi rahenge. He is very comfortable making that statement. You as a society don't have that confidence. He is very comfortable wearing that statement. He doesn't matter whether the dress is knee length or ankle length, it doesn't matter to him at all. He's comfortable wearing that cloth. take a look at what's happening in Afghanistan and tell me that technology will trump over ideology. No, patience and ideology and conviction will always win. It's a question of the time cycle that you're interested in investing. They were ready to wait for 20 years. History has rewarded them. You may not like them. You may sit and point out whatever their flaws may be. But ultimately, after 20 years, with patience, they have succeeded against the sole surviving superpower with its hyper-technology. Right? Draws a leaf out of that page. Because when I say this, are re, aa gaya Hindu Taliban. No. I am saying there is always something to be learnt even from the worst of your detractors and enemies or adversaries. Invest in your institutions. Preserve your institutions which are capable of preserving your way of life regardless of the ebb and flow of politics. Because politics is temporary, civilization is permanent. So if you keep your priorities right and you invest in those institutions which have proven to keep alive your way of life, despite the ravages of time and history, you will continue to produce people who will resist and who will bring back your way of life. Every time we have had a problem, some person, some rishi has come out to help a vibhuti. Sri Aurobindo effectively called Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj a vibhuti, as someone without whom this entire civilization would have effectively seen itself being pushed to the verge of extinction and wiped out. Such vibhutis have been created from time to time because there were institutions to produce them. Because at that time, you were resisting the sword, and the only way to resist the sword is not to offer your neck, but to draw the sword. But subsequently comes the guy who teaches you the value of tolerance. And who effectively says, you and I can coexist, but you know what, you need to change a bit. So I will introduce, with the noblest of intentions, which of course paved the way to hell, reform. And how do I do that? What you read is outdated. So let's replace your Pathashalas with English education system and the colonial education system, and let's change the language policy. If you have your civilizational love centers which have the autonomy to run their own institutions of education, I dare say whether we have the solution or not, we'll at least have the, let's say, a better group of people with much more confidence and better solutions to offer because they have been trained in that system. I am not saying kill English. I am never going to say kill English. I am saying let it be just one of the, let's say, languages of communication, but it can't be the medium of instruction. There's a distinction between knowing a language and treating that as a medium of instruction. But you can't just change the medium of instruction by retaining the very same content, because then it is deadlier that you're consuming Western education in your mother tongue, which makes the impact even deadlier. Therefore, the change has to start with content as well as the medium in which that content is disseminated. Which is why for every generation, whether it's from 98 to 2004 or 2014 to 2021, we're saying education policy, education policy. I mean, like a stuck gramophone, that's an old reference anyway. We keep saying, please change the education policy, but some people seem to be taking pride in the fact that they've not changed a single page in history books. Okay. So when this is the sense of pride from which you operate, what do? Then you can't actually tout this as a badge of honor. According to me, it's a badge of shame. Tomorrow, when it comes to a political platform, you're more than comfortable talking about how Marxists have distorted history, but you're no more in opposition to keep making the statement. What have you done is the specific question that you should be asking yourself. सत्ता आपके हाथ में है तो आपने सत्ता का प्रयोग इन विषयों में कैसे किया इसका जवाब दीजिए. That's a legitimate question to ask. If the other side asks he is anti-national, but I am pro-civilization, I am asking this question. What is wrong with the question? I am asking the question that kindly don't behave like you are the ruling party in opposition. That can't be the way you operate. When you reduce, I'm sorry, look at what has been going on. Whether it's in Bengal or Bangladesh, what is the difference today? What is the difference today? Some of those videos are horrendous, absolutely horrendous. And we seem to be issuing emergency passports for Afghans. What's happening for Bangladeshi Hindus? So we are not just second grade citizens inside the country, we are also second grade people globally, is it? How many more videos do you want before you react? Last night I was sitting with my friends, hoping to have a good time. A research scholar from a minority institution in Delhi reaches out to me, who is the product of refugee Bangladeshi Hindus, crying. I don't know her from Adam, not Adam, from Manu. I don't know her at all. She somehow found out my number, she calls, and she weeps. Imagine at the dead of the night, a woman is calling and she's weeping, you don't know how to react. But I said, what's happening? So she said, sir, I got your number from so-and-so, so-and-so, I want to talk to you. I'm a research scholar, I come from this particular lineage. My relatives are still stuck in that hellhole. People are not reporting that 300 people have been killed, not 4, not 10, not 25, 300 people. Gang rapes in the same way as 1946 and 1971 are being repeated. Mass molestations near Pandals. That news is not even coming out. Kya culture, kya civilization, bhai? You can't seem to protect these people. Hum nahi karenge to kaun karega? Pakistan. People were celebrating IPL, Dhoni's victory. I don't know what to make of it. What a suicidal community. What a delusional civilization. Dhoni has made a comeback, apparently that's what we should be celebrating. Really, what are your priorities? After listening to that girl, I said, kya kar rahe hum log? I don't even know the value of what we are doing. This is the real issue. Log mar rahe hain, aur ab cricket pe celebrate kiye ja rahe hain. Replace the victim community with any other religion. Tell me that the people of that religion would have reacted in the same way or they'd be celebrating an IPL victory. That is the reality of your situation. So stop blaming others. The problem lies within. These are your priorities. Dhoni over Bangladeshi Hindus being raped, murdered and killed. I don't know. I don't know what is the meaning of these discussions. I honestly don't know. What are we achieving? I'll write a book, it'll sell. Commercially, it'll 100% sell. What is my simple calculation? 184,000 followers on Twitter, 40,000 followers everywhere else, 25% minimum. At the very least, out of curiosity, somebody will buy. The minimum figure that you're supposed to cross to reach the bestseller section of the non-fiction category is 15,000. Chalo, ho gaya, mera toh 25,000 ho gaya, the book is won. Kya ho jaye? Iske baad kya ho jayega? Kya ho jayega? How is this helping the Bangladeshi Hindu who's being raped and murdered? I don't know. Next question. Sorry, I'll lighten up the atmosphere on the second question, the third question.
So, after reading your book, I realized that...
No, but please read up. At the very least, if you are dying, our deaths should be recorded. When the Jews were being killed in concentration camps, wait for a moment. They managed to write scrolls, capturing what was happening to them, swallowed it, knowing that they were going into gas chambers, so that if somebody were to stumble upon their bodies at some point and open the viscera, the tablet would reveal a scroll telling what happened with them. Maybe we should start considering those techniques. Next.
Hello, sir. Excuse me.
Yeah.
I absolutely love this book, and like I would not short of calling you the Vibhuti as Aurobindo had called Shivaji. But like the questions that I have aren't like doesn't say that I disagree with you. It's just something that I did not like. I would like further clarity from the book.
You're welcome to disagree with me. It's okay.
Yeah. So you have talked about how we need to reimagine or redefine concepts such as development or progress.
Continue with your question.
You've talked about how we should like redefine concepts such as development and progress, because like that are more in line with the native OETs, as you've called them in your book.
Right.
So because of a sanctity of nature. So what I would like to question you is, how would you define them, like progress and development, and does that come at the detriment of industrialization, which I agree is still a Western concept, but it has still somehow like managed to raise populations populations' living standards. And I would also like to like add on to this question, and so you've another thing that you've touched upon in the book is how for law or law and order, before in like even in the book, the local governments in ancient civilizations, ancient India, they've talked about a bottom up approach.
If you're talking of ancient India, at least call it ancient Bharat, no?
Ancient Bharat, sorry.
Yeah.
The book says ancient India, so they've talked about how the a bottom up approach was subscribed to, like when the communal life or the group life would essentially create the new kind of laws or how they are governed, a particular community is governed. So if a decolonial approach is taken towards our constitution, then won't we have to define the very minute lines of how different sampradayas are different from each other? And would that not create even more friction between different sampradayas?
Thank you. Okay, I've understood the question. So let me explain. I am not anti-industry. I am not anti-industrialization. I am not anti-development. Please understand that. Let's understand it from a very practical perspective. Compare the populations of the West and compare that with India's population, or even Chinese population for that matter. Both these countries, thanks to their flourishing river systems, have historically been areas of massive human concentrations. Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay. So both of these areas, both India and China, especially southern part of China and India, have always been massive concentrations, and they've seen massive concentrations of human beings because of the river systems that have been there. Because notwithstanding the water problem in this country, in terms of the area of Bharat and the area which is arable or which is cultivable for, let's say, agriculture, it's huge, it's significant. Very few countries are actually able to do that, notwithstanding the land at their disposal. Okay? So now take that to the next step. If 1.3 billion people aspire for the very same amenities and quality of life as 300 million people who live in a country which is three times your size, ask yourself the bare minimum question: do we have the resources for it? And should you be able to produce the resources for it? Ye to aasman se to nahi aayega. You are actually using up existing resources. So what does it do to nature is a legitimate question that you should ask yourself. Now, second, that means you don't junk development, but you redefine development in a manner which is consistent with your cultural realities and your natural or physical realities. Because travel from Mumbai to Pune, I didn't understand when would Mumbai end. It's going on and on and on. That's the same case with Noida. That's the same case, the so-called NCR. So, pehle teen city tha, abhi panch ho gaya, uske baad saat ho jayega, and this will go on. Obviously, all of this is coming at the expense of agricultural land or green cover. So, if this is the case, you will create a fantastic infrastructure which can accommodate air conditioning and central air conditioning with a terrible atmosphere outside. Is that what you want to do? Anyone who asks this question is immediately branded a leftist. Because unfortunately, environmental discourse is in the hands of the left today. But you are the ones who have effectively ceded that space without asking the basic question: how can you call yourself a Hindu or a Dharmic when you have decided to alienate Prakriti? Okay, ek minute ke liye is baat ko yahan pe chhod dete. I'll go to the next level. Can the rules of the plains be applied to mountains and valleys? Not possible. Can you expect 8-lane highways and superways in Uttarakhand and other places? Not possible. The only exception to that rule is because it happens to be a border state. You need fantastic infrastructure so that our tanks can go there. You don't make the same mistake the previous governments have done in Kashmir and Ladakh. So that you have the ability to bring your troops there. Especially with a belligerent China, you have to consider that. But beyond that, How can you think of opening casinos in, how do I put it, in Uttarakhand? Then don't call it Devbhoomi. Stop calling it Devbhoomi. There are cities for it. Go do whatever you want. That's where in a certain portion of the book, I am referring to Radhakumud Mukherjee's book, where he explains, why did we sanctify those places which have a fragile ecological balance? So that there is at least a sense of religiosity and respect that prevents people from destroying the ecological balance in the particular place. That's what you try and do. That's how you use pilgrimage as a concept to instill respect for nature. So when you do that, I am being told that people in Uttarakhand also need infrastructure. Sure, they need. But you can't ask for the infrastructure of Delhi in Uttarakhand. If that's the case, move to Delhi. You can't hope to replicate that model here. So therefore, what do? This is what happens when you simply limit dharma as religion, as opposed to understanding it is a broader philosophy which also impacts development and nature. Once you realize that, if you happen to be a dharmic state without separation of the state and church, and therefore it happens to be a dharmic state, therefore not being a theocratic state, but a state which is governed by the principles of dharma, one question that you will ask is, what does it do to the ecological balance if this project were to be initiated? Then your discussion surrounding environment will not start and end with simply an environmental impact assessment checklist. It'll go much beyond that. Because what are you looking at? There are jatis and janjatis who have traditionally protected that particular place. It also happens to be their place. Now, if you constantly follow a policy of destroying that place and displacing the tribals, you have created Naxalism. Because you have created angry people, and angry people are being pushed against India and Dharma by a vested interest group. It is no surprise, and I've said this in the book, that the Naxal belt and the tribal belt and the conversion belt coincide in this country. That is the history of this place, and I've cited material by foreign scholars who are saying as much. So look at how your disrespect for nature and nature-dependent communities has created one of the most longest running homegrown insurgent movements in this country, and you don't have an answer to it still. Because you're still looking at identity and civilization and nature in separate boxes. Why is it that we decided to give them a different space? Ye Adivasi kahan se aaye? Hum inko Adivasi nahi mante. Because when you say Adivasi, he is the first person apparently who was here, and the rest of us are colonizers. That's not the definition for us. That definition applies when the British man is here, because we are Adivasis and you are the colonizer. But when it's a discussion between Hindus, you don't use the word Adivasi. Because then you give the impression that all of us come from one race and this tribal community comes from a different race, and you've entrenched the Aryan invasion theory. The word to be used for them is Panchama. What is Panchama? People who are outside the four Varna system, the Chaturvarna system. Why? Again, I've said this in three places. Chaturvarna system is typically applicable to two places where civilization exists, meaning the village and the city, thus the Nagara and the Grama. But knowing fully well that you cannot apply the very same rules to people who actually live in the forests and the mountains and the hills, you choose not to extend the system to them. Second, the reason why you don't do that is because they have cracked the code of keeping nature intact and alive. So don't disturb them and their relationship with nature. That is our philosophy. Okay? Now here's how it plays out in the political level. I'll make this very uncomfortable. You wait and watch. So what they do is that because we have kept them at a distance to protect nature, they call you people who practice untouchability, because you don't want to extend education, apparently modern education and modern facilities to them, without realizing we want them to preserve their way of life and still give them the benefit of this. You know how that works in the traditional system? Sringeri Matha ensures, despite the fact that it has the resources to employ the best of modern kitchenry, sources its firewood from the tribals. Sringeri Matha is supposed to be a Brahminical institution. Where does it source its firewood from? From the tribals. Why? That is the source of livelihood for the tribals. Tribals will keep growing forests and replacing it so that the firewood is continuous. And you are not left without a source of livelihood. Therefore, you will not go towards the one who is giving you the book and taking the land. Okay? That is our way of protecting it. Now these groups will apparently, the evangelical groups will go there and convert them. When we try and do that to organizations like the Vanvasi Kalyan Ashram, that organization is being branded as the saffron organization, which is trying to convert tribals. Conversion kaun kar raha hai bhai? Aap kar rahe ho. Hum toh jawab de rahe hain. Look at how your respect for the tribal way of life is now being used against you. So if you interfere, you're saffronizing. You don't go, you're keeping them away from development. So kya karna hai? Catch 22. Rock and a hard place. He is saying, his answer is no. Convert karna chahiye. Lekin hum karenge. That is his answer. And what happens? You keep doing that. Effectively, you destroy that community's relationship with this country. Because it's not just the religion that you change, but the affiliation of the land also that you change. Because religion and worship of that particular deity is connected in this country. That is the deification of this land. That is a mixture of nature, because look at the background, religion and patriotism all weaved into one, rolled into one. So when you take away one, you have effectively created the next anti-Indian. So much so that the former Prime Minister's ashes can't be immersed in rivers in the Northeast. Apparently, that is desecration. Look at the deep-seated links. How nature plays a role in politics, in religious politics, as well as in real estate politics. So, understand the all-encompassing nature of dharma. You will be committing a huge mistake if you reduce it to mere religion. It is knowledge, it's a way of life. I've explained that particular statement over and over again in this particular book. Because when you tell Hindus, Hinduism is not a religion, they're like, oh, he wants to take away our constitutional rights. No, boss, that's not the argument. Unfortunately, it is being treated as religion because the constitution is understood in English. And the only equivalent that the constitution seems to be able to find for dharma in English is religion. But dharma is not religion. Religion and mazhab may be the same, but dharma is not equal to religion, is not equal to mazhab. So look at how language, I just said, vagartha vivasam priktav, it goes back to that. The word and its meaning cannot be separated. So when you keep applying religion, you will simply say, it needs to have a place of worship, it needs to have a pandit, and beyond that, iska koi role nahi hai. So temple ke role ko bhi aapne simit kar diya. A place, I'll give you the number of institutions in the south, where the pujari has to walk out with a lantern and a bell in his hand before he shuts the temple, asking for people to come and have food if there is someone who has actually gone hungry. This has been the practice of the south, not because it is the practice of the south, because unfortunately, thanks to history or no thanks to history, that is the only place where still temples and mathas are left in significant number. And apparently we should be learning from langars. I will give credit to langars where it is due. I have no problems. I see it as part of my sampradaya, whether you like it or not. But please don't tell us that annadanam is something that you have to teach us. We know that history better than most people. Next.
So after having read your book,
I will be accused of misogyny if I don't allow a lady to ask a question. So a lady has just raised her hand. Please let her and then you come. Okay? Already the Sabarimala participation has made me a misogynist in most people's eyes.
In this journey towards colonization, should we not be questioning democracy as we see it today?
Sorry, because please repeat the question. Please repeat the question.
In the journey towards decolonization, should we not be questioning democracy itself? Because whatever we spoke of today is not possible without a political will. And is democracy going to help us achieve it? That's question one. And two, in fact, the fact that you spoke of misogyny, should we not be also questioning the IPC and the CRPC laws? Because I see a lot of false 498 cases being put, and anything that you question, especially if a man questions, he's branded as a misogynist and patriarchal and whatnot. So how do we achieve it then?
There is only so much of misogynistic allegations that I can tolerate. I don't want to rake up 498A. Let a lady do that. My gender will go against me if I speak on the subject. Okay.
It's unfortunately a woman I can ask, but not a man.
It's an unfortunate reality, and that's one of the reasons whenever someone comes with matrimonial dispute, I say, Are Baba, mujhe chhod do, mujhe nahi karna, kisi bhi haal. I'm not doing this under any circumstances. I can handle even murder cases, but not matrimonial disputes. They turn out to be even worse. The Ram Kahani that comes out is astounding. Isne coffee nahi diya, isliye lapad mara, and all that. This is impossible. I can't do it. So I leave the question of 498 to people who practice trial law and criminal law. I don't practice it. So it's better that I don't volunteer with specific suggestions in that regard. There is a subject matter limitation there. I will simply leave it at the fact that it's unfortunate that when it comes to contract law, civil law, or criminal law, you have operated under the assumption that this is such a fantastic book that has lasted for over a century, as opposed to revisiting that. So there I completely agree with you. Now on the question of democracy, there is a growing discussion surrounding the concept of a second republic, which is to say that it's time that Bharat stops treating 1947 as as the point where it began, and also revisit its institutions in a very serious fashion, and you hit reset and go for a complete revamp. But that discussion is very, very premature at this stage, kyunki aapki taiyari nahi hui hai. You are not ready to answer any of those questions at a very practical and specific level. Implementation is a question, and solution is a question that you start discussing after the research is done. That's my training. The research is incomplete and it has not even begun on certain subjects. Unfortunately, the reality is hum satta mein aane ke baad sochte hain ki ab karna kya hai. As opposed to asking satta mein aane ke baad kya karenge, you would be ready for it. The other side is ready for it. That's why as soon as they come, the policy changes, the bureaucratic changes, fatak, 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 it moves. We are like, ayayayo, it's moving like a goods train. Okay, very slow, no idea, zero vision. Agar vision hai, to media se dar hai, ya leftist ecosystem se dar hai, I don't know, kya dar hai. Aray, inke baavjud ab satta mein aage, iske baad kya darna? इनके वजह से थोड़ी आए, इनके बावजूद आप आए हैं डिस्पाइट द वर्ल्ड वाइड कैंपेन दैट दे लॉन्च, इसके बाद क्या डरना, हो गया काम, अब अपना काम करते बैठो. यू हैव प्रॉमिस समथिंग, डिलीवर द गुड्स. सो फ्रैंकली प्रिपरेशन इज इंपॉर्टेंट, एंड दैट इज नॉट पॉसिबल विदाउट एक्चुअल इन्वेस्टमेंट इन स्कॉलरशिप, इन रिसर्च, फैक्चुअल रिसर्च, हिस्टोरिकल रिसर्च, एविडेंस बेस्ड रिसर्च. We seem to be laboring under the impression that evidence-based approach is the sole prerogative and the sole preserve of the West. No, this is our prerogative. We developed the Nyaya, Vaisheshika philosophies. We know what is logic. We don't need to learn it from you. So prepare that first. After Sri P.V. Karne, when was the last time you saw another person speaking on Dharma Shastras and coming out with Bhashyas and commentaries and Kritis on it? How many people have done it? So let's move in the direction of scholarship first. So whether democracy is the problem or not, I don't know the answer to that particular question, because I'm still in the process of understanding what is the dharmic conception of a state. Because according to me, it was not entirely in the form of a monarchy. It was a republican system coupled with a monarchy, where there's a certain degree of participation of certain communities and certain elders, so to speak, in the Raja's election itself, or his selection itself. It is not an insular process. It is not a non-consultative process. It is not a unilateral process. That much is clear. There are very good books on the subject. So I just, I happened to be educated on the subject by someone else who told me, please read the works of Anand Kumar Swami, who specifically commented on this particular subject. You read him, then there is K.P. Jaiswal. Read these books. I'm still in the process of doing that. You will get a better sense of how do we craft those principles to make decision-making easier for the purposes of civilization. But don't look for anti-democratic solutions, because if the other side were to occupy power, then you don't have a solution. You're stuck with them as well. So you need a check as well as a balance. How many more questions do we have the time for? 7:25. 15 minutes? Okay, done.
Sir, may I ask mine?
Because I don't want to go under the presumption that they're more than happy to hear me for eternity. Go on.
Yes, sir. So after reading your book, I've started seeing coloniality in places where I didn't before.
Very good.
And it's everywhere. It's in law, government, politics.
That's why I called it the Matrix.
Yeah, exactly. I remember. Architecture and even everyday life. So is achieving complete
decoloniality even a possible reality? And what is the roadmap? I mean, I just found myself in a chakravyu after reading your book with no way out.
No, see, I'm drawing hard from the fact, when you say it's there even in architecture, you're absolutely right. Imagine having glass buildings in the furnace in, let's say, in Gurgaon and other places. Glass buildings in a place which is bang in the Tropic of Cancer. We must be geniuses, yeah. I don't know how that even works. So even in architecture that shows, I'll tell you what, some of the apartments which are sold in Delhi, they're named after streets and places in London. Hyde Park. Really, Connaught Place. This is, that shows you, because now renaming is apparently communal, but the original naming was secular. Wonderful. So I'm not a pessimist because I can't afford to be. Two, the discussion, I'll give you a slightly different answer to it, a counterintuitive answer. 5 or 6 years ago, I don't think there would have been an audience for this kind of a topic. There wouldn't have been an open articulation of these issues. I don't think the success of the book reflects the originality of my contribution. It merely reflects the existence of an audience which is willing to consume it, which has been waiting to consume. So regardless of me, if someone else had done the same thing, I'm absolutely sure the book would have been a hit, 100%. You don't get a Modi because there is one who exists, but because there is a society that's ready for it. So therefore, I am drawing hard from the fact that something's up in the air, that we are moving in a certain direction. Otherwise, people who wrote on Savarkar have been banished from public life. And today we are seeing authors who have written on Savarkar being celebrated finally. Vikram Sampath. So, clearly there is a shift. And someone asked me this beautiful question. The gentleman is sitting here in the audience. He was there at Solanki today. The Overton window is shifting. There he is. Google, what is the Overton window? Law students, you need to know history better. So Google, what is Overton window? Which is the shift in public perception of a society which is moving in a certain direction. And the Overton window right now is moving in favor of pro-civilization voices. That is showing in multiple ways. Politically, culturally, academically, whatnot. I'll give you a pop example. Could Tanaji have been a hit before? Would it have been made before? Would the dialogues have been allowed before? There is an open reference to Aurangzeb and Jai Shri Ram. Okay, done. Cruder example. Could Bahubali have been made before with that kind of imagery? That's the answer. So the public is ready and has started asking the right questions. So people who are willing to produce works which moves the window further and which pushes them further in the direction are the ones we currently need. Then the answers will come. Frankly speaking, your ancestors have lived through worse. So don't think that you have had it bad. At least you have the internet to talk and shout. There was a time when you only had the print medium completely in the hands of one clique, and all you could do was write letters to the editor. And the editor will say, isko kude mein pheko. It doesn't come from my side of the spectrum. Okay? So learn to use the existing tools of dissemination of opinion and shaping of opinions to push your message, but not through empty shouting and whining, but with solid, pointed, razor-sharp preparation. Medium hai, sadhan hai, madhyam hai, to uska satupyog karna seekho. Don't talk about Aryan Khan. Please don't. What difference does it make? All of us know where it will go. Do you expect him to be convicted? Nothing will happen. Forget it. Aryan Khan and Dhoni were our obsessions where Bangladeshi Hindus were being butchered. So as much as there is enough cause for hope, there is also some room for despair. So let's try to push it further in that particular direction through preparation. Next. So the answer to this question is, there is hope. 100% there is hope. your dharmic imagery has now hit pop culture, which is a sign of upward percolation. Okay? There are two streams. One is the downward filtration theory, the other is the upward percolation. Hitting pop culture is a great thing, because that means pop culture has realized the economic incentive of showing it on big screen. Next.
Good evening, sir. My name is Malhar Vinod Satav. I'm a first year law student at National Law School of Bharat, Bangalore. And my question is, you argue in your book that internalization of this civilizational consciousness is nothing short of an historical imperative in today's day and age.
Correct.
And you base this argument upon this indigenous ontology, epistemology and theology, set.
Right.
So how does this theoretical or theoretical philosophical construct is translated into our daily practical lives, where we fight this colonial hangover looming large over our civilization without being branded either as a revisionist or without being cancelled?
Fair enough. Okay, so I'll give you a concrete example, and since you come from my fraternity, I'll answer that. Read the National Education Policy. Paragraph 16.7, if my memory serves me right, is the only paragraph dedicated to legal education. Read that. Not one reference to introduction of the Shatdarshanas or the six Indian schools of philosophy in legal education. So, kya national education policy? Are you have not, and what are you looking, you're looking at AI ko legal education mein kaise introduce kare? Is that what is called indigenization of education policy? I would ask, when students are being taught jurisprudence, which is the fundamentals of the law, and they don't have exposure to Indian philosophy, what is an 18-year-old supposed to assume? That India's contribution to jurisprudence, which is worth reading, is sunnah, zero, cipher. That's the impression that you create. So you start with that. Then, second, you know for a fact, they know for a fact, that when there is no law, we fall back on taught law. And when it comes to taught law, you fall back on common law. Common law is directly traceable to principles of Bible as established by Privy Council judgments. Common law is sourced exclusively from biblical principles. Why don't we start talking of dharmic principles for the purposes of taught law, immediately applicable? Where is the problem? That's point number two. Point number three. In terms of indigenization of thought and practical, let me just, because a lot of people have asked me, I'm happy that you didn't ask me the question, because that means you've understood it. Why have I used ontology, epistemology and theology in that particular order? Because people are like, kya bole ja rahe ho? What is this? Shashi Tharoor ki tarah bas pheke ja rahe ho. Okay. I said, no. I have explained. I have shown what I can do. The point is, ontology, epistemology, theology ka matlab ye hai. Ontology is a society's understanding of metaphysics, which means the relationship between individual consciousness and the supreme consciousness. That's where your knowledge begins. There is not a single Vedika school of philosophy out of the six schools which doesn't start with this fundamental question as to what is Atma and what is the relationship between Atma and Paramatma. The discussion starts from that. And that is exactly how Christian ontology also begins. The difference is, they have a different view of the soul and the relationship between soul and God. We have a different understanding of Atma, which is not the same as soul, okay? And the relationship between Atma and Paramatma. So that is the basic distinction. So once, when someone makes a stupid statement, all religions are the same. Pagal, okay, they are not the same. How can they be the same? Theoretical foundations hi alag hai, bhai. Theory agar alag hai, toh applied sciences kaise same ho sakta hai? Then, what is epistemology? When metaphysics is then translated or reduced to knowledge systems, where you make it science so that you can understand the metaphysics better, that translates to epistemology or your manners of learning. Okay? Since everybody is not capable of understanding metaphysics or knowledge structures, you need theology. Because the common man cannot understand all of this, he doesn't have the patience for it, he doesn't have the training for it. Now, I'll give it an engineering twist. I have done thermodynamics, I have done stress analysis and all of this in my previous avatar. So there are certain equations known as Euler's equations. It's EULER is not Euler, it's Euler. Okay, so it's not Eureka, it's Eureka. The common mistake that you make is it's Eureka, Eureka. Nee, nee, bhai, it's Eureka. So Euler's, let's say, equations exist. The engineer knows which equation to use, but he can't formulate an equation himself because he is not a theoretician. That is the difference between theoretical sciences and applied sciences. That is the distinction between metaphysics and knowledge and religion. So when I use this, I'm saying these are the basics. Now you're applying Christian OET to Hindu institutions because you're saying deity and God are the same. And since everybody can enter all places in the church, all Hindus must be able to enter the sanctum sanctorum, which is Garbhagriha. Because he's saying, wo karein, tum nahi kar sakte ho. I had this genius question thrown at me. If Muslims allow their women to enter Haji Ali Darga, will you still object to women of reproductive age group entering Sabarimala? I said, 100% yes. My position will not change. Because my position is not dependent on what he does. My position is dependent on what my tradition tells me. So, ye apples aur oranges ke beech ka jo comparison hota hai, this has become the Hindu philosophy. Usne thappad kha liya, tum bhi kha lo. Are, mujhe thappad hi nahi khana hai. Why should I actually say equal treatment means that stupidity or whatever they do, I should also do? I'm not saying that stupidity. I'm saying you do what you want to do. That's between you, your consciousness, and your religion. I will not subscribe to it. Reverse logic, then we do a lot of things. We worship the feminine. Worship the feminine. Do that. Bring back the deities which worship the feminine. Talk about it. You ban books in that name. You don't allow even books to be read on that name. तो ये क्या लॉजिक है भाई, वन वे स्ट्रीट. सो देयरफॉर आपके जो फंडे हैं ना, पूरी तरह से हिले हुए हैं, टू पुट इट इन दिल्ली लैंग्वेज, विच इज योर ऑन्टोलॉजी इज गॉन फॉर अ सिक्स, योर थियोलॉजी इज गॉन फॉर अ सिक्स, एंड योर एपिस्टेमोलॉजी इज गॉन फॉर अ सिक्स, बिकॉज यू हैव कंप्लीटली क्रिश्चियनाइज योर वे ऑफ लुकिंग एट हिंदुइज्म. सो देयर इज वन इज टू कन्वर्ट फ्रॉम वन रिलीजन टू अनदर, द अदर इज टू कन्वर्ट योर ओन रिलीजन इन द मोल्ड ऑफ द अदर. सो it is happening with us both ways. Hindus are also converting to Christianity. Hinduism is also being converted to Christianity. Amazing. So therefore, the most practical way is to first of all understand the significance of a temple. Respect that particular place and its rules. I had one genius on Twitter basically saying, comparing nude sauna beaches in Germany with dress code for temples, because there was a video that was released with respect to Mangalorean temples saying women cannot wear these clothes and men cannot wear these clothes. Some genius put out saying, ye kya rules ho sakte hain, bhagwan kuch bhi sehlenge, bhagwan to ye nahi kehte hain, tumhe kuch pata hai bhagwan kya kehta hai? And who are you to say that? It's a training. You're nowhere qualified to make such statements. You assume that on religion everybody can say everything, but on law only lawyers must speak, on medicine only doctors can speak, on education only teachers must speak, but when it comes to religion, it's free for all. You don't respect the specific training and the anushthanas and the training that they have to go through for this. Because no, Brahminical patriarchy, you see, kya kare? Okay.
Namaste, yeah. Sir.
Namaste. Okay. We'll end it with a lady.
I wanted to ask you, sir, how do you define Hindutva, and is there a difference in Hindutva and Hinduism with reference to the pro-civilization consciousness that we are trying to awaken?
See, it's a fairly simple concept to understand, so let me try and break it down. One is a religion, or let's say dharma, and the other is the essence of your existence as to what qualifies as Hinduness. But why is it important? Assume that this is Bharat and there are only Hindus inside. Fictional situation, or at least what used to be the case once. I don't need to invent or define the concept of Hindutva among Hindus. When does it become relevant? When there is an outgroup which becomes part of this. Then you are asking yourself, what is the line that separates the Hindu from the other? What should be the conduct of the Hindu when he is being told that his religion is based on superstition and his existence is that of a subhuman? So the very existence of Hindutva is necessitated by the need for resistance.
So your resistance as a civilization in the interest of self-protection, in the face of aggression, when beset with an existential challenge, is Hindutva. Hindutva is dharmic, civilizational reawakening and reassertion. That is what it translates to. Yes, sir.
Namaskar.
Namaskar.
In the wake of your discourse, you spoke about the aggression taking on in Bangladesh and few days back in Kashmir also.
Ji, ji.
Few people were asked for their Aadhaar cards and they were shot dead.
Correct, correct.
How should we get prepared for that? The coming days. How should we get prepared for such a situation in coming days? Because I see it's coming on our doors also.
Correct. With multiple waves of illegal migration, it is a reality. And this state has a lot of illegal migrants. Huge. Coming from multiple countries. Something common in between both the groups. Gradually, I think the state is proving to be ineffective and incapable of protecting us. Then give us the constitutional freedom to protect ourselves. The British man took away your arms to dull your ability to resist, and he banned your martial traditions. And therefore, today you think you're a society that has never known how to wield the weapon. And you think of yourself as a defeated, cowardly society, which is not the case. Perhaps you should start thinking of certain unorthodox solutions, but within the constitution. I will leave it at that.
Sir. Sir, आपने अभी जो point बोला, अभी इसके बारे में बोल रहा हूँ कि गुजरात और महाराष्ट्र में गुरुकुलम करके एक स्कूल जो चल रहे हैं, लास्ट टाइम जब ट्रंप ने इंडिया में विजिट किया था तो उनको वहाँ पे स्वागत किया था. सो इसको एजुकेशन पॉलिसी के अंदर फोकस नहीं किया जा रहा सर, इसमें इंडियन कल्चर और इंग्लिश दोनों का कॉम्बिनेशन कर रहे हैं.
जी जी.
और ये जो मार्शल आर्ट्स आप बोल रहे हैं सब उसमें इंक्लूडिंग है मतलब.
तो एक इशू ये है, एंड इनफैक्ट ये एक सजेशन पहले भी बहुत सारे लोगों ने दे रखा है और इसके बारे में मैंने पहले भी बात कर रखी है, दैट अगर उनको हमारे हिस्ट्री को नहीं पढ़ना है तो नहीं पढ़े, नो प्रॉब्लम. देन अलाउ अस टू सेट अप अ सेपरेट बोर्ड. You have a problem with the existing board and its syllabus and its textbooks being changed. Good. Keep that problem, no problem. Allow us to set up a different board. History has multiple interpretations. Jisko hamari interpretation ko padhna hai, wo hamari school mein dakhil ho jaye. Jisko nahi padhna hai, mat aao. Baat khatam. Kya problem hai isme? Why is that not happening? Separate board. We will craft our own history. We will support it with primary evidence. बच्चों को जो पढ़ना है पढ़े, जिनको वहाँ पर भेजना है भेजे. वील टेक द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी. टेम्पल्स विल डू इट. फ्री द टेम्पल, हम अपना पैसा इस्तेमाल करेंगे. सोल्यूशन तो है. तो बार बार ये हम हिस्ट्री टेक्स्ट बुक को चेंज करने की जो बात किए जा रहे हैं, उनको ये नहीं पढ़ना है क्योंकि उनको लगता है कि उनको तकलीफ होगी या अनदर. नहीं भाई, उनको बिना तकलीफ दिए हम ये काम कर सकते हैं. सो दीज आर ऑब्वियस सोल्यूशंस. I don't need to really say these are rocket science solutions. Clearly available. Done? Okay. Aaj ki sabha yahi pe samapt karte hain. Yeah. Yes, sir, yes, sir. One last question from sir there. Yes.
Hello.
Yeah.
Huh? Hello. I'm also Deepak Bhadkamkar,
Achha.
Birthplace Hyderabad,
okay.
Metallurgist from Regional Engineering College, Warangal.
Okay.
I worked for 29 years in Cummins, India. Okay. My question is, how do you, where is our India, Bharat, compared to the modern world now, US, the West? How many years back in development and everything? We have so many untapped resources in India, Bharat, for the last 75 years. We could have been much more higher,
right?
Much more longer.
Right.
Kya ho gaya? Politics mein, isme, bhrashtachar, कितना तो भी पैसा अगर 20% भी लगाते तो कहाँ तक जाते थे। चाइना ने क्या किया है, किसी भी प्रॉब्लम का ओवर पॉपुलेशन ये रीज़न नहीं है। डोंट कंपेयर, इफ़ यू वांट टू कंपेयर विथ चाइना, कहाँ तक गए। अभी आई वांट टू सी ये डिकेड में 10 साल में हम कहाँ से कहाँ पहुँचना चाहिए। वी आर एग्रीकल्चर कंट्री, वी शुड सप्लाई टू ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड एवरीथिंग। देर इज सो मच अनटैप्ड ओवर दिस मेटल्स एंड ऑल दैट। आई एम मेटलर्जिस्ट,
राइट।
आई एम सॉरी टू से, सॉरी।
ओके, शुड आई रिस्पॉन्ड और वाज दैट ओके, फाइन, ओके, ठीक।
आई विल कॉन्टैक्ट यू लेटर ऑन।
ओके सर, सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल या चाइना ने तो बहुत तरक्की कर ली, आप सही कह रहे हैं, बिल्कुल सही कह रहे हैं। The only thing is it has come at the expense of foggy cities, smoggy cities, and please take a look at what the last 2 weeks have been saying. Some places have become completely unlivable. And if you treat nature as only a source of pulling out ore on a regular basis, uske upar jo hai uska kya karne wale hain, iska bhi hum jawab hame de dena chahiye. Okay? That's exactly what I was trying to say. Second, to assume that no country, I mean, corruption is less and that's why others have actually survived. Sorry, corruption is a fantastic American way of life. Okay? It's not as if these countries are not corrupt. जब ये करते हैं तो बहुत ही बड़े पैमाने में करते हैं. Okay? It's mega always. The point is slightly different. आज आपने समझ लीजिए मुंबई टू बैंगलोर का आपने एक मेट्रो का कॉरिडोर बना दिया या फिर हाई स्पीड रेल आपने बना दिया, आपने इन्वेस्ट किया. You made sure that the taxpayers' money is invested in genuine infrastructure. Okay, done. Patharbazi baad mein hogi kisi issue pe. Like they did in Bengal, they uprooted the railway lines. After years of investment and money that was being spent, they uprooted it. The Indian state was unable to protect its own investment in infrastructure. My point is, if you do not address civilizational challenges, every investment in development will go down the drain because other issues will stop you, and therefore for once and for all you must address this issue. If you don't take that particular position, what will happen is that the law abiding groups will continue to produce money for national growth and investment, and the ones who don't contribute will keep destroying it, and we will all be justifying it in the name of secularism. Sir, when let's say infrastructure is developed, surely it's not our case that it is meant for one particular community. So the ones who believe that this is investment by one particular community for a particular community, उस दिमाग का आप क्या करेंगे, उसका क्या निवारण है, उस रोग का क्या निवारण है, आप मुझे समझा दीजिए। Because it's not as if he doesn't understand that this is for everybody's use, or for that matter in some cases she doesn't understand. So to reduce this to a simple question of development, no, your problem is that on every question of development you will face a religious hurdle and a cultural hurdle and a civilizational hurdle. It is not possible for you to look at development in this country purely from that particular perspective because you are not a homogeneous country. Unfortunately or fortunately, that history will decide. Therefore, to compare China, you want to do what China does? Fantastic. What did they do? They invented the Han identity, and after they took over Tibet, they pushed their people into Tibet to ensure that there are more Han Chinese in Tibet. So ye development jo ki aap baat kar rahe hain, it is not divorced of culture. Let us see if any government in this country has the guts to send a massive Hindu population into Kashmir even after abrogation of Article 370 or amendment of Article 370. Ye nahi hoga. Kaun kar raha hai aaj? Jo ja rahe hain wo mar ke wapas aa rahe hain on four shoulders, right? So understand that development without a very clear identity vision or a civilizational vision is absolutely useless discussion, because it will be a one-sided investment that will be destroyed right in front of your eyes in your lifetime because other issues are constantly holding you back. So
In fact, in 2019, before the elections, I was asked to speak on this particular subject. I specifically said, you have to address civilizational legacy problems, because without them, every investment in Vikas will go right into the gutter. Thank you. I leave it at that.